the Pali word for clinging, upadana. The Thais take it and they give it an interesting meaning. The Thai word is upatan. And the meaning they give it is best illustrated by an example. You're sitting alone in a hut in the forest, and you hear sounds outside. Maybe the sound of a person walking around your hut. A little sound here, a little sound there, and the mind stitches it together. And you're convinced that there's a ghost outside. That's upatan. You create a whole narrative. You create a whole other being out there, simply out of little bits and pieces of sounds or maybe sights. And you can stitch it into something that's really scary, overwhelming. And for a long time, I didn't understand how that was related to the word upadana, the clinging. But if you stop and consider how we cling to our addictions, you begin to see the relationship. If you're addicted to a certain type of behavior, you create a whole sense of need for that behavior. You are a person who has that kind of need. But what do you create that sense of need out of? It's little tiny sensations in the body, little thoughts that flit through the mind. Say that you've been addicted to cigarettes. There's certain symptoms in the body that you tend to try to treat with a cigarette. And after all, you begin to interpret those symptoms when they come as a sign of a need. You've created the need out of whole cloth. Not quite whole cloth. There are little sensations in the body. Sensations in the back of your hands and sensation in your chest, whatever. But you take these little impulses and you make them more than they have to be. You also create a sense of yourself around that. You are the person with that addiction. You are the person with that need. This is a very direct way in which the Buddha, very direct way of illustrating the Buddha's principle that our sense of self can lead to suffering. Because we create a sense of self that actually wants something unhealthy and knows that it's unhealthy. So the way to work around that is through the discernment that cuts through your clinging. One of the Buddha's definitions for the strength or faculty of discernment, faculty here, is a bad translation for the Thai, for the Pali word indriya. It means more like a dominant factor in your mind, something that's powerful and strong in your mind. And one of the definitions for this strength or this faculty is knowledge of things rising and passing away, or simply knowledge of arising and passing away. Without even the things, just the process of arising and passing away. And it's usually interpreted as a very advanced stage of vipassana, or insight. But you don't have to wait until you're in an advanced stage. You can simply look at what's going on. What are the sensations that trigger that whole story, that trigger that whole storyline that says, oops, there's that need showing itself again. Can you look just at the sensations arising and passing away? Because part of that storyline is that when they arise and pass away, they're going to come back. And they're going to keep coming back until you finally give in to them. Which is a very unskillful storyline. Yes, they will come and they will go away, and they'll come again and they'll go away. But if you learn not to give in to them, it's not the case that they're going to grow bigger and bigger. They will go away again. Of course, it's helpful to have an alternative way of dealing with those sensations. That's why we practice meditation. That's why we practice concentration. Is to give the mind a ready access to a sense of well-being that it can tap into whenever it needs. And a sense of well-being, you will create a different sense of self around that. You're the competent person who can access this well-being. So you provide yourself with a different storyline and a different standing point for the mind. It's not such a precarious place that it's pushed around by the slightest little impulse. And it can begin to question those interpretations that you build around the little impulses. The storyline that you build around them. Say, if the impulse comes and goes, it's going to come again. So you might as well give into it now so it doesn't come back again. But of course it comes back again, and then you give into it again. Well, it's hard to say that you give in to the sensation. The sensation just comes and goes. You give into the storyline. You give your credence to the storyline. It says, I need this. The sex drive is a great example of this. Certain symptoms arise in the body and the mind. You say, oops, there it goes. Got to give in. But they come and then they go. It's not that the body needs sex. The mind creates a story. A sense of self, a sense of what's out there in the world, a sense of what's inside in here. That would induce you to give in to the desire for sex. But the actual impulse, if you sit through it and learn how to breathe through it and learn how to relax the body around it, it's not that overwhelming. We talk often about physical needs. The body doesn't really have that many needs. The body would be perfectly content to die. We're the ones who want it to survive. We're the ones who want it to feed and do all the other functions that we like. So you have to look into the mind to see how the mind stitches things together, this process of upatthana, stitching little sensations together and making a bigger deal out of them than they have to be. This is one of the reasons why the Buddha has his focus on just arising and passing away. What's immediately apparent, immediately present to the mind. Without going into the stories of whether there's something behind it out there or something experiencing or some agent in here that's experiencing it and dealing with it. Just look at these sensations coming and going in and of themselves. And you begin to realize they don't have the force that you attributed to them. Now, the reason you attributed it to them is because you wanted to use them as an excuse. But when you can begin to see that they lead you into unskillful behavior, you don't have to play along with those attributions anymore. So the Buddha gives you a two-pronged approach here. One is get the mind into concentration. This is why strong concentration is so essential to the path. As he said, even though you may see the drawbacks of certain desires, if you don't have the sense of pleasure that comes from jhana, you can't withstand them. You've got to have an alternative source of happiness, an alternative source of pleasure and ease. And at the same time, you need the right way of looking at things. When the Buddha set out dependent co-arising, he wasn't trying to impress people with what a complex idea he could cook up. Some of the most important features of dependent co-arising are right on the surface. And one of those features is just that. You look at things on the surface without trying to guess at what lies in the depths. And you reduce these things to simply their passing away, arising again, passing away on the surface. You see that they're not nearly as powerful as you thought they were. They're not nearly as compelling as you thought they were. That puts you in a position of greater strength. So when you learn to look at these things simply as stress arising and stress passing away, and realizing that you have better ways of dealing with those simple sensations, it goes a long way to overcoming whatever addictions you may have. The deep-seated drives you attribute to the mind. Are powerful because you think that they're deep-seated. When you learn to see them simply as constructs that you've placed on top of very superficial and ephemeral sensations, things that come and go very quickly. It may seem disorienting because your sense of who you are many times is based around those needs that you've created. But when you've got an alternative way of functioning, an alternative way of seeing yourself, you're not so threatened by the idea of letting go of those old ways. So it's a combination of right concentration and right view. That can help you pass these issues. I remember talking to a scholar one time who was very concerned that Buddhism not be treated as a psychology. It was more serious than that. He said, it's a philosophy, it's a metaphysics. He didn't like the idea that it was just a therapy. And I countered by saying, well, I don't like the idea that it's just a philosophy. Therapy is more important. Right view, right concentration, these are meant to be therapy for the ways the mind creates suffering for itself. And if addiction is a way it creates suffering, well, you want to be able to use these tools to get past an addiction, your old ways of clinging, the stories you create, the being inside and the situations outside that you stitch together out of sensations when you really look at them are really not that powerful at all. When you learn how to let go of that habit of stitching these things together, you find that your problems are not nearly as overwhelming as you thought they were. You can gain the upper hand. So keep this point in mind. The Thai way of interpreting upatthana may not quite correspond with what's in the Pali Canon, but it does give a good insight into the process of what clinging is all about. How to take apart the clinging so you don't have to keep causing yourself suffering.